All right. Hey everyone. Neal with channelfireball.com once again here. Today the plan is to do another Amonkhet draft. Now last time, the set had pretty much just come out, so you know, I didn't know exactly where I wanted to be and I'm still figuring that out. You know, it's a week later. I've learned a lot, but there's still a lot to learn. Let me make these cards a little bit bigger for us. Going through here. Okay, so out of this pack, I think the best options are Magma Spray, just because it's super efficient. I think it's better than Compulsory Rest. Vizier of Deferment is good, but I don't think the pick here. Yeah, I'm just going to go with Magma Spray. I think between it, Nest of Scarabs, Compulsory Rest, those are all good, but hard to go wrong with this. Even Mind Sensor is really more of a constructed card than anything else. Trying to make the text right on the cards here. They look a little blocky. Alright, next up, we get this Electrify or Bone Picker. Probably our best options. I think they're just two of the stronger cards in the pack. I like Fanbearer too. But what do I want to go with here? I think Electrify is good enough where we just picked Magma Spray, so there's no real reason to take a different color. Yeah, I mean, I think Bone Picker or Fanbearer are reasonable. Even Initiate's also quite good. But all of them are, like, within the realm, like, you know, within the same power levels, roughly. So in those spots, I like just taking the on-color card. I love Vizier of Tumbling Sands. Love, love, love that card. Probably more than a lot of people like it. It just does so much. The combos with Exert, Mana Ramp, just all the kind of just giving your best thing Vigilance. All these things are, add up to an awesome card. And it just happens to cycle. But I think here again, I think Vizier is a bit better than Emberhorn Minotaur, but not so much that I want to take it over the Minotaur, because the Minotaur is definitely a top three red common, though probably worse than both of these. But I think it's definitely the best after those. 4/3/4/4 is already just pretty reasonable stats, and when you get to Exert on top of that, you have a pretty nice card. Naga Vitalist, also a card I've been pretty impressed with, as is Gustwalker. So there's just a lot of good playables in this pack. Grimstrider, I have not really seen that card be great. Like, I respect it, but I don't think it's anything to write home about. I guess just another Minotaur again, because if we look here, in fact, I think Minotaur is just one of the best cards in this pack. The pack's a little bit weak. I like the Sandworm a little better than Minotaur in general. And I think green's just really deep. No, I was about to say maybe I would take Sandworm over Ceridon. I probably wouldn't, just because, again, we're just all red so far. So no reason to deviate, as we were saying. I haven't actually gotten to play any blue cartouches yet, but I do think that card is quite powerful. It just takes a pretty specific deck to really want that card. Just like a really blue aggressive deck, which exists. I just haven't had him yet. All right. Now we're finally to a pack where I think the red card is not the best card. I think Unwavering Initiate is the best card in this pack. But again, I think Thresher Lizard is not so much worse than the Initiate. I mean, they're both three drops that I should take the Initiate over Thresher Lizard. So we're just cutting red really hard. What this means is that in pack two, we're very likely to see a ton of red because we didn't pass very much. Unless, of course, the person underneath us is mostly in one color, doesn't even have to be red, and then they open up a red bomb and just start taking that and then cut red hard in pack two. That could happen to us, but more likely than not, what will happen is we're just going to see some good red cards. So that's part of the benefit of being able to take all of these. I've actually been really impressed by red cartouche. You don't want a ton of them, but it's a nice lava axe with Amberhorn Minotaur. You just play the Minotaur, play Cartouche. Sometimes that's just the game. And obviously combos with any trials that we may get. And just is really good with what Red is trying to achieve here. Hazard's Monument, I don't really like that much. It's just, you need to get so many loots before it ends up being worth it. The only monuments I really like are the green and white ones. The white one, just because the effect actually is useful the whole game. And the green one, it helps you stay ahead and get ahead from parity, and lets you just slam like green creatures ahead of schedule, which is actually pretty nice. We've been missing a 2-drop, so this is perfect. Failure to comply. Not really interested in that. I'm curious as to what the God Pharaoh's gift is with the gate to the Aetherlife. But we're going to have to wait a few months for that until Hour of Devastation releases. I think I like Thresher Lizard better than Desert Ceridon. Usually when I take the Ceridon, I end up just never actually casting the card. It does get nice if you have some payoffs for cycling discard type cards like the Adept, the 1-mana 1/2 with Menace. Monastery Slow Spear has been called a few times. Actually, no, sorry. Monastery Slow Spear is the other one, the prowess creature, the rare guy. Whew. There's a lot of red 1-drops that happen to be 1/2s with abilities in this set. So now you know. I like Brute Strength, but kind of only want one. I just like it. It's great that this Entangler came back. I don't think it's the best red 2-drop. I think the best red 2-drop is the Initiate, which gives 2 power creatures unblockable. But it is nice to have here. Xena Seeker to jump things or Honed Kopesh? I actually think Xena Seeker is the pick. We could easily splash that. And I think if I want a Honed Kopesh, I can get it later on. Companion is not really the type of card I want to take, because then if I'm really heavy red, a green 2-drop is less exciting than, like, you know, this card that I cast later that really goes over the top. I've actually been kind of impressed by Bloodlust Insider. I think the card is fine. But I think one of the archetypes of this format is just, like, the all-in red deck. Just a ton of really, really cheap threats playing, like, anywhere from 14 to 16 lands. And Cradle is a nice pickup if we end up playing that deck. And so right now we're reasonably set up to just be mono red. We've taken pretty much all red cards. So there you go. Nice little sideboard Violent Impact. Not going to play either of these. Look, I got to collect my swamps for the collection. I'm sure you understand. I'm carefully not taking the other card so I can't accidentally put it in my deck, because it's just that bad. So I could take Threaten, a card that gets way, way better when you have cycling, or Magma Spray. Magma Spray does sometimes get awkward if you have too many of them and your opponent's just playing big creatures, but it's just so efficient that I think I would pick that up here. No real reason to move out of red either. Like, I think the Crocodile is by far better than these, but the upside of not having to play another color is pretty nice. Like, if I knew for sure I was going to play 2 colors, I'd just take the Crocodile, because I do think it is a step up. But I don't know that I have to move on anything yet, and Magma Spray is quite good. So again, I'm giving up a little bit of power to really just maintain a focus, which has been really just a theme of this particular draft. Ooh, Combat Celebrant. If it has not been exerted this turn, you can exert it, and then go crazy. Alright, cool. Lots of combats. That's going to be pretty awesome. Let's go ahead and pick that on up. Blood Rage Brawler definitely can put people on the back foot and just win before they can do anything. So, pretty happy to grab that. I'm moving the Xena Seeker to the sideboard for now. There's a chance it makes our deck, but don't think we need it yet. No real red cards. We could take Grasping Dunes, but I think taking a cycling land is kind of awesome. If we can just cycle once we hit, you know, once we get to 4 mana, I never need another land. So a non-color cycling land is pretty fantastic. And if I happen to play red, if I happen to splash green, that's upside. All right, another Thresher Lizard. Again, this is what I'm talking about, the Hone Kopeshes. It's a common. Most decks don't want them. I think the red deck can sometimes play one. Just kind of uses your mana in places where you don't have anything else going on. This is actually a pretty tough pick between the Sure Shot and the Entangler. I already have a lot of threes, so I think I'd rather just take the two drop to make sure I'm curving out every time. Also to note, Bloodless Insider get a lot more exciting when you have Combat Celebrant in your deck. So if I just go like Bloodless Insider into Entangler attack into, I guess, Celebrant haste it, don't exert, but then the next turn play something and haste that and then exert, the game kind of just ends. It's almost a turn 4 kill, so. And I think it's quite a turn 4 kill. You deal 2 damage on turn 2, and then 6 damage on turn 3. This is probably a turn 4 kill if your opponent literally plays no spells. Desert Cerrodon. I've heard of a lot of people winning with Approach with the Second Sun, and I'm pretty jealous I haven't done it yet. But there's still time in the format. We'll get there. Nimbleblade Kenra. I have a decent number of non-creature spells. Again, it's not exactly what I'm trying to do. Cursed Minotaur is better, but again, not really a splash card, so I'll just keep taking my red cards. We need really some more 1-drops. I wouldn't mind taking a second Insider at some point. I really do think this card is underrated. Not that it's good. Well, it's good in the sense that when it works, it's really good. It kind of functions almost like, I've heard it be called like a red mana elf, because what it does is it accelerates you a turn. Elvish Mystic's going to get you to that 3 mana on turn 2, so you can attack with your 3-drop on turn 3. But Bloodlust Insider, when you play your 3-drop on turn 3, it's just hasting and attacking. So in a lot of ways, it kind of is the red Elvish Mystic. Oh, wow. Well, Limits of Solidarity, that's awesome. So, just perfect. There was one other red card in that pack. I'm trying to remember what it was. I think it might have just been like a Thresher Lizard. But I'd much rather have the Limits of Solidarity than a Thresher Lizard. Because that pack, we had the choice between Magma Spray and the Crocodile, which I was talking about. And then I was talking about how, you know, this card is good, but we weren't taking that at the time. Our deck looks pretty nice. So I've had a mono red. Well, actually, I haven't had a true mono red deck yet in the format. I've had an almost mono red deck. I had a red white beatdown deck that played 15 lands so far. So this might be a first. We're definitely on track to be mono red too. But I've also had a mono white deck, which focused on having a bunch of the on crop, I think are called captains, the 2/2 flyer for 4 that exerts and pumps your whole team. I had 4 of those. It's probably more of a sideboard card than anything. And that deck actually just performed great. I just had some fan bearers, tapped down a couple of my opponent's creatures, and just pretty much every game I was setting up some overruns. So I didn't think it would work that well, but it does. And this format definitely encourages consistency between cycling and all the various mechanics working together. There's almost always something you can be doing. And, you know, just these monocolor decks also encourage that, because you're going to basically never get, you're never going to get color screwed, obviously, unless of course you draw a million deserts, but if that happens, it's kind of your own fault. And yeah, I think there's just a lot of ways to build super consistent decks in the format, which is pretty awesome. So pack 3, we're looking to open Glorybringer, preferably. Non-color rare would be nice, although it's pretty hard to get an on-color rare when you're only one color out of the 5. But a man can dream, right? All right, how about a blue rare? You selling me on a blue rare? Not really. So this is, I could take another Entangler, but it might wheel. I could take the Charioteer, which is actually a decent splash, because if I play that later on, just giving everything trample is still reasonable. Or I could take Cartouche of Knowledge, I think. I guess I'm going to do that, then take the pull from tomorrow. I think I already have three Entanglers. There's a good chance this comes back, so I'd rather take a more powerful card here and hedge. Aven Initiate's reasonable. Just gives my deck a little bit of reach. A lot of these picks will end up just as throwaways, but what gives me the most upside? I guess the Charioteer is kind of nice, because I just already have the Thicket, so just giving all these guys trample. Yeah, I think I'm going to take that. Don't know if we're going to play it. Wow, cut? Doesn't even matter if I don't play Ribbons, I'm just taking cut. I would say we cut red, but we're getting past red in pack three, so instead it's just the hookups. We would be happy with the Blood Rage Brawler too. Cut to Ribbons is so ridiculous. I am pretty fortunate, because I think that might be my most opened, like, this might be the rare I have the most of the set, which is not a bad thing. I also like that you can cast Ribbons off of Gift of Paradise just by itself. You can have no other black in your deck, and just sometimes you have double black. That's really, really nifty. The little Gravedigger is pretty good, and I mean, we have Ribbons, so if I take a few black cards, then suddenly that becomes a thing. I'm gonna have to take something here. I called this On-Crop Captain earlier, but it's Top Crop Elite. I was way off. Anyways, this is the card I was talking about earlier that I played set that one draft. Yeah, I'm going to take Gravedigger, and maybe we play Cut to Ribbons. Maybe we don't play Gravedigger or Charioteer. There are a lot of options. Oracle's Vault. Well, my deck's mostly just trying to beat down, so it's not really something I'm interested in. I do kind of just want to take Bloodless Insider. I guess Oracle's Vault, what it does do is give me inevitability. Like, when I'm ahead, it functions as a 6-drop. And then I can just keep playing things. So maybe I should take that. It's also good in certain matchups. Like, if my opponent is super grindy, I can at least board in Oracle's Vault when... when I don't think I can win otherwise. Because I think I'm going to get one of these two red cards back, probably. Alright, I don't know if we'll play it main, but it's a pretty good option to have. Oof. It's bad. I'll take this guy. I do like that the black cards are at least higher up on the curve. Get the old cycling land value here. Or do I want another Minotaur or a Threaten? Or I guess a Thresher Lizard. I don't think I want another Thresher Lizard, though. Threaten's kind of the last card you cast every game, so even though it has cycling, I still probably would rather just have another Minotaur. There's a lot of Nephcrop Entanglers, so probably one of those will come back. So yeah, I'm just going to take another Minotaur. Ooh, Pursuit Glory is actually a card I could be interested in, and it has cycling. There are a lot of Gate to the Afterlifes. Alright, now we get a Thresher Lizard. I think I'm probably just not going to play black, even though Gravedigger is good. Just getting to play all mountains has pretty big upside. Mostly because Magma Spray and Cartouche kind of turn all my other cards into double red cards. Yep, the Entangler came back. I'm hoping the other Insider wheels. I had a deck where Nest of Scarabs was just incredible. The main wombo combo with the card is Soul Stinger, because you get to put the counters on, get some insects. When it dies, you put more counters on, get more insects. and that is just a lot of value. So that is definitely a deck, the Nest of Scarabs counter deck. Ooh, Manticore is a good way to just close the game. I didn't take it last time. I think I took Gravedigger over it just because it was so much more powerful, but I might play it here. This is kind of a combo with Combat Celebrant too. You get the pump twice. So are we going to wheel the other Bloodlust Insider? Let's find out. Right now I'm at 15 lands. I think this was the pack with the Insider. Alright, so I did not. Which is kind of a bummer. Maybe I should have just taken it the first time. So this, we could play 15 here, or, let's see, let's make these cards a little bigger. There we go. Also, do I want to play Oracle's Vault? It's not really, again, the type of card I'm trying to play. Like, it's a 6-drop. It's not that exciting. This card's also kind of medium, but it is another 2-drop. This is 7 2-drops. How many cyclers do I have? I have 1, 2, 3 cyclers to help it hit land drops. My curve is reasonably low. So I could play 15 lands. I think 16 might be better though, because I have a cycling land. So that kind of encourages me to put an extra land in my deck, and I don't have that many cyclers. So I could just cut this Kenra entirely. I just don't have that many spells. I have 18 creatures in my deck. Yeah, let's just do that and play 16 plus Cradles, a land that I sack a good amount of the time. So mounting it up. Oh, sorry, Swamps. And we've got a deck. Let's see how it goes.